Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good evening and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Lewis Chaitin, a member of the City Club Board of Directors and a partner at Jones Day, the sponsor of this event. I also happen to be a former law clerk to the justice whom Judge Gorsuch has been nominated to replace. So I'm particularly excited about tonight's forum, a conversation with leading Supreme Court scholars about the nomination of Judge Neil Gorsuch to the Supreme Court of the United States and the future of the court. Judge Gorsuch was nominated on January 31st when President Trump selected him to replace Justice Antonin Scalia, who passed away a little over a year ago. But the nomination process for his seat began long before Judge Gorsuch's nomination. It began when President Obama nominated Judge Merrick Garland for this vacancy. In what continues to be viewed as a controversial move, the Senate declined to hold hearings on Judge Garland's nomination during a presidential election year. Some see this as unprecedented, pointing out that since 1900, the Senate has voted on 8 Supreme Court justices during election years and confirmed 6. But others see the circumstances as unique, pointing out that it has been over 80 years, long before the modern politicized era of Supreme Court nominations, since a Supreme Court justice has been confirmed to a vacancy that arose in an election year. That debate rages on. But whatever the merits of that debate, a new debate has begun, whether Judge Gorsuch, I'm getting a little ahead of myself, should be confirmed to the U.S. Supreme Court. Judge Gorsuch is currently a judge on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 10th Circuit, based in Colorado. He is highly regarded and personally and professionally. It remains to be seen, however, how the Senate will react to his nomination. We will know soon enough. In just 6 days, the Senate begins its confirmation hearings. Republican leadership has expressed the desire to have Judge Gorsuch confirmed by mid-April. No one can say for sure whether and how that will be accomplished, with bipartisan support, over a filibuster, by use of the so-called nuclear option, or not at all. Fortunately for all of us, today's event will give us insight on Judge Gorsuch's nomination and the process. We have a terrific panel tonight with views on all sides of the issue. This is a politically charged and controversial topic, which means it is the ideal topic to discuss here at the City Club, with its long tradition of providing a forum for civil debate. Moderating our panel today is Brandon Cox, an associate at Tucker Ellis. Brandon is a graduate of Georgetown and Cleveland Marshall College of Law and a member of the Federal Bar. And before I turn things over to Brandon, I did want to mention that we have Judge Polster with us in the audience today. Thank you for joining us. And with that, I'll hand things over to Brandon to introduce today's esteemed panel.
Great. Good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here. We, each of us, met in the back and decided that we were just going to jump right into the conversation because we have so much that we want to talk about. However, we do have here Professor Adler, Mr. Jeremy Paris, as well as Professor Schiavoni joining us today. So we are going to jump right into a discussion. I am going to start things off with a question to Jeremy. So as mentioned, Judge Gorsuch's confirmation process begins on March 20th, 2017. That's just about 6 days or so from now. Walk us through what the process entails and the type of issues that we can expect will be addressed throughout the confirmation process.
First of all, thanks for coming. Thanks for being here. And I do want to say, all of a sudden, you do these things. I know about the issue. I get nervous when I have my parents here. Not one, but two bosses here. And so this is where you really get exposed. I do not have professor next to my name, so I don't have to be the legal heavyweight. My background is I worked in the Senate Judiciary Committee, and I worked on actually 5 nominations to the Supreme Court, if you include the Harriet Myers nomination. to the Supreme Court, but Chief Justice Roberts, Justice Alito, Justice Sotomayor, and Justice Kagan. And it's interesting. There's a part of this period right now where I was talking to my old colleagues. I'm so happy not to be there because the sleepless nights and the long thing, the process actually began a long time ago, and not just because of the thing I'm sure we'll talk about with the Garland nomination, but the preparation, the reading, the background, all that work. But let me just tell you the one story. So you've got the legal prep and all the stuff that's going on to prepare and forecast. What I was doing the day before the hearing started was Justice Sotomayor, Judge Sotomayor, not to get ahead of ourselves, but she was confirmed. Judge Sotomayor had broken her ankle. And so she had to have her foot elevated during the whole hearing. And so what I spent a few hours doing right before the hearing started was making sure that there's a stool under the desk so she could keep, you're supposed to keep your foot elevated. And these are long hearing days. So, I was thinking to myself, wow, this is a good use of my law degree. what are we going to be looking for? I think it's a mistake to judge these things just by the scoreboard of are they going to be confirmed or aren't they? That's clearly a part of this. But I think this is the one sort of democratic moment when we repose enormous power and authority in the Supreme Court, who are not elected, and ultimately have this enormous role in our republic. And this is the moment where the stakes become clear, where the president gets to nominate, the Senate gets to offer advice and consent, and the hearing is that moment people sort of pay attention to what is the court, what does it do. And so I think it's something that senators take seriously. I'm sure others will have a thought on this. I think what I am personally looking for next week is, I think this is a very unusual time with President Trump and the Trump administration, where there were challenges when he was a candidate. There have been challenges since he's been in office to the idea of the independence of the courts. And remember, the courts can't defend themselves. They don't have an army. During the Cherokee Indian removal case, and Andrew Jackson was, trying to move the Cherokees out of Georgia, Chief Justice Marshall said, issued a ruling, says, no, you can't. And Jackson, this may be apocryphal, but said, Chief Justice Jackson's issued his decision, now let him enforce it, which really speaks to the vulnerability of judges. So what I am looking for is Judge Gorsuch going to be, show the kind of respect for the important independent judicial role that we need on the court? And I think that's a thematic that I would be shocked if we don't hear that through line through issues and issues next week, at least on the Democratic side, but I would bet on both sides. Did I filibuster that? I did work in the Senate, so.
No, just fine.
All right, good.
Professor Schiavoni, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the elephant in the room, perhaps, Judge Merrick Garland nomination process. So the United States Senate arguably invented a procedure to block the Judge Merrick Garland's nomination, primarily reasoning that President Obama should not be able to appoint a nominee during an election year. Can you explain to us the practical implications of this procedural maneuver and how it might pan out in future presidencies to come, particularly when there might arise another situation or an opportunity, rather, for a president to nominate a Supreme Court justice during an election year?
Well, first, thank you so much for having all of us here. I think it's such an important topic to be discussing. This situation was particularly unique, not only because of the justice whose seat became vacant, but also because a lot of people thought that this would be the time that quite possibly the Democrats, I guess since 1969, could have a majority of seats on the bench. So I'm not convinced that that had a different vacancy at a different time in the same part of a president's term, I don't think it would have been treated the same way. So to answer your question, no, I don't think that this necessarily sets a precedent. I don't think that nominations will be treated like this in the future. I think this was a raw power move by pretty much Mitch McConnell and Mitch McConnell by himself. I don't think he probably, I don't know if he talked to Grassley or if he talked to many of the other Republicans, but it sounds like he didn't. And it was a big gamble and he won. So I don't think it's gonna actually set a precedent because of the variables that I set out. And I would be surprised if the Democrats treated it as such.
Professor Adler, do you agree with that viewpoint, that this is unlikely to be some sort of precedent set for how these decisions are made going forward?
The way, I mean, I agree that it was a unique situation. And again, you know, thank you for all being here and being part of this conversation. Glad to be here. I think I agree that it was fairly unique. I agree it was a power move. I also think, though, it was the inevitable and predictable action in that situation. President Obama's White House counsel, in a candid moment, said had the positions been reversed, she would have recommended the exact same course. Going back to every time there had been the possibility, or there believed there was a possibility of something like this happening in the post-war period, we have seen this come up. So in 1956, there's a late vacancy. Eisenhower recess appoints William Brennan to the court. William Brennan being from the other party, thinking that might be a cute political move, but also he thought that nominating a Catholic to the court would help him in the upcoming election. Senate Democrats, even though it was a Democrat that was nominated, were furious. And in 1960, the Senate passes a resolution saying that sort of thing should never be done again. We know that the timing of Warren's retirement affected the vote for Fortas. Republicans in the Senate who might have otherwise supported Fortas's elevation to chief, instead, from the moment Warren announced that he was stepping down, that they would not accept filling the Chief Justice spot on the eve of the election. Senator Biden gave an infamous speech in 92, raising these sorts of concerns. So I think that this was something of a unique moment. It was something that we would have expected. And the other reason we would have expected is that for at least the last 30 years, we've been in a ever-worsening cycle of escalatory retaliation over judicial nominations. The way I think about it is, you're on a road trip, and your two kids are sitting in the backseat of the car, and they're squabbling over something. And initially, they're kind of just jostling each other. And then jostling's not enough. Eventually, one of them decides they've got to shove the other one. And and eventually, they're hitting each other, right? And at some point, who started what is no longer relevant. The point is that they're slugging each other in the back, and each one has to make sure that the lick they get in is better than the one before. That's the way the senators have been behaving for at least 30 years on judicial nominations. And so there was a perfect storm here. You had a nomination that would have transformed the court in an election year, and Senator McConnell, as Sarah noted, said, this is going to motivate the Republican base. This is going to put it online for the election. I'm just not going to schedule a hearing. And is it ugly? Sure. Did it keep a qualified person off the court? Without question. But it's not as if this was something that we didn't know would have happened in this kind of situation.
So, respectfully, I disagree. I mean, Mitch McConnell definitely got in the best lick in that fight, right? Sure. I mean, this was, and I mean, we, not to relitigate the Merrick Garland situation too much, but, five times in the last 100 years, we confirmed Supreme Court nominees in the presidential election year. It would not have been unusual. It's February. He was challenged by people like Orrin Hatch for years to, if you nominate a consensus moderate like Merrick Garland, they should have a swift confirmation. He nominates a consensus. And frankly, I disagreed with the politics of it. I mean, I would have made a much more aggressive pick that might have had more of an impact in the election. But here's the takeaway, because to go back to your question, which I think both of you addressed about, is this the future? I had this job where I was always counseling. We need to be careful with how we approach these things. The precedent we set is going to matter because we have to live with it. The Democrats were in the minority and President Bush was president. I knew the perils of being in the minority. And so I was like, wait, we got to be careful and live with it. What I learned from, because I think Mitch McConnell made a bold political move. He's been bragging about it since, saying, this was a key to Donald Trump winning the election. I frankly think the Gorsuch nomination is a key now to keeping certainly the evangelical conservative right wing sort of in line with a president they may not love. But what I learned was so people always ask me, can they do this? Well, it's not a legal process. It's a political process. It's political will, right? And Mitch McConnell made a political play. Didn't pay for it. In fact, won bigly, right? We're still all adjusting to the new language. I don't even tweet. But I think what I learned, and this is my lesson going forward, is I don't think the Democrats would have blocked a nominee in a similar situation. I think maybe they should have, but I think until the political base on the left takes Supreme Court nominations as seriously and judicial nominations as seriously as the right wing has taken it for a generation, I'm a Democrat, we will be outflanked on this. And so I think that's got to inform not only how this nomination goes, but how we look at the courts going forward. These issues have enormous consequence on issue after issue. And we, you know, that's something that I had a frustration when I was on the Hill. So my politics, though, of carefulness is sort of anachronistic. I mean, it's like I would terrible advice. Apparently.
The other thing I was going to say is that I think it's pretty unique that we actually had a death of a justice. And I think that this actually is going to be the death of
a legal giant.
Correct. But that the vacancy wasn't planned. And so I think that this is actually going to have an impact on justices thinking about when they will retire, when they won't retire. We know that that happens with lower court judges all the time. So we may not get the opportunity to test our theory because they may be thinking, okay, well, if I'm thinking about it, I'm not going to do it even close to February, push it back November when it is. So a lot of this is really in the hands of the justices, and I think that that might be eliminated.
So objectively speaking, Judge Gorsuch is a well-respected and qualified Supreme Court nominee. Indeed, the American Bar Association has rated Judge Gorsuch well qualified to serve on the Supreme Court. Professor Adler, what then appears to be the concern regarding Judge Gorsuch being confirmed as the next Supreme Court nominee?
I'm probably the wrong person to ask because I don't have a lot of concerns. I think Judge Gorsuch will be a fabulous justice. I should confess, I did not support the president's election. I signed a list of academics saying that he could not be trusted to nominate qualified constitutionalists to the court. And I'm in the position in some respects of eating crow in the sense that it's hard to imagine a better nominee than Judge Gorsuch in terms of temperament, thoughtfulness, and the way he approaches the law. I mean, he is the sort of person that I would have wanted any president to nominate, and I admit that I was somewhat surprised that's the course the president took. But I think that if confirmed, he will right away have an impact on the court because he's not merely a judge with a particular judicial philosophy who's likely to vote in a particular way, but he's someone who is incredibly thoughtful, who recognizes that even everyday decisions often implicate broader legal principles and that it's important for judges not to lose sight of that. And I think that's the sort of thing we want on the court. And assuming he is confirmed, which I think all of us expect that he will be, I look forward to reading his opinions for many years.
So, Jeremy, do you think that some people who have pause with the nomination, is it with Judge Gorsuch, or is it still this sort of residual effects of how things panned out in terms of how we got here? Because again, he on paper, he's incredibly qualified, and there appears to be no reason to question whether he'll be.
I think there's no question that the context of what happened with Merrick Garland matters, but I think it matters less than the context of President Trump. Look, there's no question that we have these sort of Judge Gorsuch is very non-Trumpian. He's very much a traditional judge. He served on the Tenth Circuit for years. He's out of central casting. But you're not casting a person to be a judge on TV, and you're not just looking at their firepower, how smart they are, and how qualified they are. I see somebody who's very ideologically to the right of anybody on the court, with the exception probably of Clarence Thomas. It depends on the issue. I know smarter people than me are going to tell me that's reductionist and silly, but on issues that matter to me, I look at somebody. First of all, the President Trump said he would pick somebody who would overturn Roe v. Wade on day one. I've got to believe that was a litmus test for why he was chosen. I want to know that. But my core thing that I'm looking at is the judicial independence piece. Is this somebody who is going to be a check on executive power and executive power overreach? I see somebody who in his career has sided with corporations over on disabilities cases, with corporations on the most troubling case, I think, out of his career is the architect of the Hobby Lobby decision, which we could talk about for a long time. This is going back to my experience, then I'll just shut up. But the one of the few cases that really resonated with, I know with the left, but with everybody during my time doing Supreme Court nominations was the Citizens United case. somehow the idea of money and politics really hit home in a central way because it got to the fairness of our system. And I think when people got worried about what corporate personhood meant, what they were worried about was something like the Hobby Lobby case. Judge Garland was the architect of Hobby Lobby. And this decision said that that corporations have religious views that they can use to decide whether or not their employees get certain kinds of health care or not. This is it was the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, that they have religious liberty interests under that act, a corporation. And to me, I need to know more about, you know, to unpack that and understand that, because I do look at who is the court for. And here I fear that it is not for people looking to protect their rights.
Professor Schiavoni, let's talk a little bit about Judge Gorsuch's record. Based on what you know, cases, research that we've done, what does his record suggest in terms of a position that he might take on women's rights, LGBT rights? And is that something that we should be concerned with in the way that media appears to be portraying it as this major issue?
So first, I might defer some of those more sort of legal principle questions to Professor Adler. I'm a political scientist, and of course, we only care about right-left, we only care about liberal-conservative. And so, I mean, that's not really true, but we like to measure things in judicial spaces along unidimensional lines and all these things. So what I would say is that some very smart political scientists did an analysis looking at the common judicial space and placed Judge Gorsuch along the continuum relative to the other justices on the bench. And he is far more conservative on I think they did 15 or 16 issues, far more conservative than even Justice Alito. And that these are issues ranging from not only religious liberty, but also in economic substantive due process cases and economic cases and disabilities cases and in LGBT cases. So, I mean, he's just across the board much more conservative than even Justice Scalia was in some of those cases, on defendants' rights cases. So I think that he's going to move not only, he's not going to be the pivot justice, so he's not going to move the pendulum that much on a particular outcome, but he certainly will be pulling the court to the right. And the one thing I wanted to say was listening what Jeremy was saying about...
you can correct how wrong I was.
No, there was something you were saying that I've not lost it. So...
Well, Professor Adler, so. let's talk about this notion that... data suggests that Judge Gorsuch is likely to be more conservative than Justice Alito and perhaps even more than Scalia. Is that really, do you think that's really going to be the case?
I don't. And let me say a couple things. I mean, one, you know, he's called the architect of Hobby Lobby. The thing that upsets most folks about Hobby Lobby, the recognition that when the Federal Dictionary Act defines person to include corporation, that a federal statute should be interpreted that way. Well, only two justices were willing to disagree with that in Hobby Lobby, right? The issue of whether businesses could be was 5-2 on that question. So, I mean, Judge Gorsuch's opinion, which was in line with the Supreme Court, hardly out of the mainstream. Is he likely to be like Justice Scalia on many issues? Yes. But if you look at his record on issues that we're talking about, like deference to authority, he's shown himself to be far less deferential to the executive branch, to the police, to government power than Merrick Garland. You can find cases in on the 10th Circuit where Judge Gorsuch is to the left, quote unquote, of his colleagues on things like qualified immunity for police officers. It's really hard to find cases where Merrick Garland was doing the same sort of thing on the court. When you look at Judge Gorsuch's opinions, when you read them, when you look at his votes and cases, you find someone that's really trying to get the answer right on the law and is being driven by that, not his own personal preferences. Some of the cases that were highlighted in the New York Times this week, if you actually go and look up those cases that are being pointed to, you find Judge Gorsuch being in unanimous panels. The disability cases that he's being criticized for are cases where the panels were unanimous, where he was the only Republican on the panel. So that doesn't show him to be particularly outside of the mainstream. Now, is he an originalist? He certainly claims to be. I expect we'd see that. Is he a textualist? He gave a speech in honor of Justice Scalia at Case last year, which apparently was one of the things that caught the White House's eye when making this choice, where he certainly endorsed Justice Scalia's approach to how you interpret texts and how you interpret the Constitution. And so I think we certainly expect that. But you know, we say, you know, he's going to be to the right of Justice Alito, and I don't think so. He's going to be someone who's going to apply a Scalia-like methodology. And as with Justice Scalia, that will, at times, make him a quite conservative justice. But like Justice Scalia, that will probably, at times, put him on the other end of the court. Justice Scalia was simultaneously the most anti-criminal defendant justice and most pro-criminal justice defendant lobbyist on the justice on the court, because he said the text matters, and where the text gives criminal defendants a right, it's not for us to water that down. And I expect you'll see something similar with Gorsuch. And will that mean his modal tendency will be conservative? Yes. But it's not like you're going to be getting a partisan person or someone who's not independent. And on this, to end with this, the Jeremy's concern about, you know, with judicial independence, which I think is a huge concern. It's hard to think of another possible nominee the president could have chosen that is less likely to try and cater to or bend to the will of the president that nominated him than Judge Gorsuch. That's just not something, when you look at his record, that is all in his character.
I want to just pick up on one thing, which is, I mean, of course, Professor Adler is exactly right. You can't look at and say, this is where they are, and this will be on every issue, and you're also talking about decades.
Right.
So you don't always know what the hot issues are going to be, what's going to come before the court. The hard issues come before the court. They change, people change, and the law changes. I do feel like looking at the current court and saying, well, that's judicial mainstream, I just want to challenge that a bit, because I consider what we've seen during the Roberts court to be an alarming right-wing direction of the court. Gutting the Voting Rights Act was one of the worst decisions, in my view, in recent American history. The Citizens United decision and the entire corporate personhood side of things. I think these were decisions that show a court going the wrong direction. And so if he continues and deepens that, I feel like this is where context matters. You know, Justice Scalia was 80, and nobody, of course, expected his death. And it was a huge loss to the legal community. I mean, I grew up reading Scalia, but you know, he's 49, so he'll be on the court a long, long time. And this is the one moment we have to look and understand. So I look at the article he wrote, I think it was in the National Review Online, that criticized LGBTQ groups for looking to the courts to protect their rights, saying you should go through the political process. This was a common theme. And of course, we have the marriage equality decision, which is an important protection of rights that the court was absolutely right to issue. And then you have decision after decision finding rights for corporations on the court. Somehow that's appropriate. So I go back to, this is the moment we have to look at this. I'm like, who is the court for? What is the direction arrow of the court? What is the direction arrow of the nominee? So I mean, it's no surprise we disagree. But I think that it's just, I guess I want to go back to the first thing I said. It's, I think there's almost a relief that, wow, it's a normal judicial nominee, mm-hmm. right? And that, but I think, you know, normal, you know, this is somebody that, yes, a Jeb Bush, a Marco Rubio could have selected for the court. But I think we should judge him on his merits and really look, and whether he's confirmed or not, this is a time to analyze and judge and look at the direction of the court and whether it matters and how it matters.
One other thing is, I remember circling back to what Jeremy had said. So I think your initial question was, what should we look for and how could you maybe oppose him? Mm-hmm. And I think that the Democrats were really struggling with this question as well. And we didn't really see a concerted message on how they were really going to confront the Gorsuch nomination until just a few days ago. And now I think we're starting to hear about the fact that it's the little guy. So that we've heard this narrative now over the past couple of days that Judge Gorsuch has always been on the side of the big corporations, or everything is against the little guy. So I'll be interested to hear in the hearings if that narrative is brought up, and whether or not the interest groups on the left, which are usually activated and really interested in nominations, which we haven't really heard of, I don't think, as much as we probably should have, whether or not they're really starting to get that narrative out there. I mean, just today, this morning, I saw another, the first commercial I'd seen. So today, the NRA started it's like a $2 million campaign, pro-Gorsuch campaign, on that if we don't nominate him, or if we don't confirm him, our guns are going to be taken away. So the NRA and the Chamber of Commerce are certainly out there sowing the narrative, and I'm wondering if the liberal groups will as well.
So, Professor Adler, probably end up ending with you on this question. Obviously, this is a major nomination. Tell us why this matters. So, in the grand scheme of things, we're going back to 5-4 court. Is there going to be any major difference in terms of having Judge Gorsuch on the Supreme Court than say it has been before the passing of Justice Scalia?
Sure. There are a couple ways in which we can anticipate some differences with Justice Scalia that could matter on a 5-4 court. I mean, first, anytime there is turnover on the court, you get a change in the court's dynamic. Because, you know, this is a group of 9 people that are working very closely together like a committee trying to decide very difficult legal questions. And you start to learn the other folks that you're working with, what cases they want to hear, how they might decide a case. Having a new ninth justice means they've got to wonder, well, is this a case I want to take? Is it not a case I want the court to take? How do I interact with this justice? You know, how reliable is this vote? So on. So that dynamic will change, and you're going to get a period, mm-hmm. transition period, no matter what. By all accounts, Judge Gorsuch doesn't have the sharp elbows that Justice Scalia would occasionally have. We know of cases in which Justice Scalia had majorities that he lost because he was not willing to tone down the rhetoric of some of his opinions.
Is that a known thing?
There are some cases from I think, the Blackmun papers and from another set of papers that have been released where we saw cases in which Scalia lost some votes.
Well, that's a whole fascinating topic for another...
And that's just not, you know, Judge Gorsuch is just not... That's not, you know, he's like Justice Scalia, he's an elegant writer, but he doesn't have the zeal for throwing punches in his writing the way Justice Scalia would.
So, do you think that's going to be a welcome? People are going to welcome that to the bench?
I think so. I mean, you know, I'm not sure about the current justices, and in part because we don't have the records to tell. We do know that before justices like Justice O'Connor were sometimes alienated mm-hmm. by Scalia's approach. You know, we get to see the records and the papers, you know, decades after the cases happened. So, you know, we don't know if that dynamic still exists. An area where we think we will see a difference is relates to deference to administrative agencies. Justice Scalia was the court's foremost proponent of a very vigorous Chevron doctrine. This is a doctrine where if a statute is ambiguous, courts are obligated to defer to any reasonable interpretation put forward by the agency. Scalia vigorously defended this, thought it, and often dissented alone in efforts by the court to constrain the doctrine or to say it doesn't apply in certain contexts. Judge Gorsuch has written a handful of opinions raising questions about the Chevron doctrine. And what's interesting, given the narrative people want about, you know, big guy versus little guy, these cases didn't involve corporations challenging regulatory agencies. These cases involved individual immigrants who were unlawfully present in the United States, who relied to the, it turns out to their detriment, on prior court decisions about whether or not they could seek an adjustment of their status. And the Bureau of Immigration Appeals came along and said, well, the statute's ambiguous, we interpret it another way, you lose, sorry. And Judge Gorsuch wrote some very powerful opinions saying, for an agency to be able to come along and do something like that and to use Chevron as the basis should really trouble us. It strikes us as being retroactive, it challenges our notions of due process, and it has effects, perhaps the greatest effects, on some of the most vulnerable, right? The folks that can't hire the army of lobbyists to influence the agency, the folks who are kind of beholden to the agency's whims. And I think that will change the discussion about questions of deference to agencies on the court. I don't expect Chevron to be overturned, but I think on a lot of subsidiary questions, I think his presence as opposed to Scalia will change that conversation.
I'll hold my thoughts in response to your question to thing, my view on his environmental. I just want to say, if you had Chevron deference in the Supreme Court drinking game, now is your time to have a drink.
So, yeah, also textualist, originalist, and some other things that I need to Google later. I'm Dan Malthrop, CEO of the City Club. Tonight we're enjoying a panel conversation on the nomination of Judge Neil M. Gorsuch and the future of the Supreme Court, featuring Jonathan Adler of Case Western Reserve University School of Law, Jeremy Paris, former Chief Counsel for Nominations and Oversight for the Senate Judiciary Committee, and Sara Schiavoni, instructor at the Department of Political Science at John Carroll University. Our moderator is Brandon Cox of Tucker Ellis. We're about to begin the audience Q&A, and we welcome questions from everyone, City Club members, guests, students, those of you joining us via our webcast. If you'd like to tweet a question, please tweet it at the City Club, and our staff will work it into the program. We do want to remind you that your questions should be brief and to the point. Holding our microphones today, our marketing and outreach coordinator, Faye Walker, and director of programming, Stephanie Jansky. May we have the first question, please?
Thank you. Since 17 intelligence agencies have concluded that Russia tried to interfere in our election of Trump-Pence, shouldn't we wait until the ongoing investigations are done and concluded before giving Donald Trump a lifetime appointment to the Supreme Court?
I'll say no. First, as a very practical reason, if we're concerned about the overreach of this administration, and I admit I share those concerns, right? I did not support Trump's election. I want a 9-member court because I don't want a court that's potentially deadlocked on really important legal questions, particularly if they pertain to the legitimacy of executive action. Had the nominee been someone different than Judge Gorsuch, I might have felt differently about that question. All right, if it wasn't someone that had a track record of judicial independence, of being an independent thinker, I might, you know, if it had been, you know, if he had nominated, one of the, his real estate lawyer back in New York, I might have been concerned about that. I also think, that there are all sorts of things that affect our elections, It should not surprise us that foreign powers try and affect it. It's bad. We should want to know about it. I hope that Congress does fulfill its obligations to investigate this sort of thing. But the legitimacy of the outcome in terms of the casting of electoral votes is what it is. If Donald Trump were to step down, you get President Pence. Do we really think President Pence would be nominating someone different? Of course not. If President Pence has to step down too, then it's President Ryan. Right, so I mean, it's not as if there is something out there that alters.
The CBO score gets to decide. No. Sure. I have maybe a different answer a little bit though. First of all, I think Jonathan is absolutely sincere, knowing him for years, that this really is the kind of nominee I think you really have been fighting for. I think the context of your question is. This isn't just the normal fighting and partisan fighting after an election. There are legitimate questions that relate to the electoral process, how it was influenced. And now I think a constitutional crisis that is less about the election and more about the willingness of Congress to step in and conduct serious oversight and be that part of check and balance. That's the context that I think matters for this nomination, which is, what is the court's role in that? So I think you have this the sort of crisis of are the parties acting in accordance, and so do you wait? I go back to my answer where it's political party. I mean, it's political power. I think if the Democrats were in charge of the Senate, I don't think we'd be here. I do find it amusing that, of course, Mitch McConnell was out 20 minutes after Justice Scalia died saying this president will not get to pick a nominee. I expected that kind of fight to be a day or two later after you have the usual talk about his legacy. The minute that President Trump was elected, he said, well, we can't wait a minute with a 4-4 court. And these were senators on the Republican side who were saying, yeah, we could leave this open for 4 years. So let's understand when we're urged that we have to move with all expediency and right now to get the person not confirmed by the middle of April, so they're there this term, that's nonsense. It can wait for the process to happen the right way.
First of all, I'd like to thank the panel for coming out on such a cold winter's day in Northeast Ohio.
Not on such a cold winter day.
I'm not a lawyer. I'm a layman. I would like somebody on the panel to explain to me the process of the nuclear option and explain it so that somebody who's not a lawyer can fully understand it.
Sure.
And you're not a lawyer, right? So
no.
You have a shot at common sense.
Right.
All right.
We'll see. So in this context or in 2013 when it was actually invoked, we'll do both. So essentially, the president has the authority to nominate a cabinet member, or in this case, a judge or a potential justice, and then the Senate gets to confirm. There is an informal rule, right? Informal rule, which is the filibuster, which allows the minority party in the Senate to essentially prevent a vote on the nominee unless there's a cloture vote. A cloture vote requires 60 votes. So that's where we come up with this idea that it requires 60 votes to confirm anyone to the bench or to a cabinet position. In 2013, and maybe Jeremy wants to step in because I know he has some opinions on this. In 2013,
I was out of the Senate by then.
Harry Reid, who was the Senate Majority Leader, invoked the nuclear option, which essentially said, we're not going to allow filibusters to prevent lower court judges and or cabinet members from being confirmed. So they essentially, by a simple majority vote, changed the rules of the Senate to disallow the filibuster on nominees. So what in fact that did was, the nuclear option is to say, this is the only or one of the biggest ways the minority party can prevent the majority party in the Senate from getting their way, and the nuclear option, they blew it up. Now this did not pertain to Supreme Court nominations. So that's what we're dealing with right now. Whether or not the Democrats filibuster this Supreme Court nomination, and whether or not then the Republicans invoke the nuclear option, which says we're going to change the rules, which would allow him to be confirmed by a simple majority.
I believe that if the Gorsuch nomination were in peril of being filibustered, that Mitch McConnell would absolutely, invoke the nuclear option and blame Harry Reid for having done it before, and going back to the Hatfield and McCoys of this old fight, right? He showed his hand when he stopped Merrick Garland cold from even having a hearing. There's no question he would. By the way, it's called the nuclear option because you're supposed to have a two-third vote of the Senate to change the rule of the Senate, and instead it was changed by an appeal on the rules to the chair, and it was a simple majority, so it was considered like a nuclear bomb, like a secret weapon. I have a whole thought on the rules of the Senate, which seems so arcane and ridiculous, actually have a meaning. All right, and that underlies them, which is unlike the House, where a simple majority rules, the Senate have what I've called rules for grown-ups, which are, right? See, that everybody understands, right? Which is, it's just a five wins, four loses. It's that, each senator can hold up basically debate forever. You can invoke objection after objection. You need unanimous consent to really do anything in the Senate. And what that means is it's supposed to be a cooling off, and it pushes the Senate towards consensus actions. Most of the time, even controversial Supreme Court nominations have gone through. They have not been filibustered. We'll see. I also think the question of the filibuster is almost premature. I mean, I understand why people ask. I'm looking forward to seeing what happens at the hearing, understanding how is this reacted to, and what are the issues that come out, and where are senators after that?
If I could just a couple of things for historical context, which I think is important. Jeremy's absolutely right. The Senate traditionally has operated by supermajority rules requiring greater consensus, and that's included changing of the rules. But what's interesting is that historically that was never the case with judges. So the first time any judicial nominee was ever filibustered in our nation's history was Abe Fortas. Abe Fortas did not have a majority support, so there weren't even 50 votes to end debate, let alone the 60 for required. And it was bipartisan. The opposition was bipartisan, a motley mix of different groups opposing him for different reasons. So that was the only case until 2003, when a guy named Miguel Estrada, who everyone saw as potential Supreme Court nominee, was filibustered. And then several more of President Bush's nominees to lower courts were filibustered. No judicial nominee had ever been filibustered before, other than Fortas, and certainly none that had bipartisan majority support. And yet it happened to, I think, eight. And then eventually there was the Republicans were considering whether or not to invoke the nuclear option. And that's when the name came about, because the idea was to change the rules to force these nominations through would be such a dramatic move that it threatened to blow up the comedy in the Senate and the ability of senators to work together. And so then Senate Majority Leader Bill Frist was reluctant to invoke this. And then a bipartisan group of senators called the Gang of 14, seven Democrats and seven Republicans, agreed that they would provide the margin both to end debate on a select list of nominees, but also vote against any effort to change the rules. And so that diffused the controversy, and then the controversy came away. And then when President Obama was elected, Senate Republicans said, well, our folks were filibustered, we're going to filibuster yours, and we're going to do it a little bit more, because it's like those kids in the backseat of the car again, right?
Well, they filibustered Obama's very first
Yes.
Judicial nominee who he selected after consulting with Richard Lugar, the senior Republican in the Senate, which in my view was the reaction to President Obama across the board, was to delegitimize him and not have the normal processes. And of course, the Republicans didn't have to filibuster Bill Clinton's nominees. They controlled the Senate, didn't let any have hearings.
Well, except for the first 2 years, because he hardly nominated anybody in the first two years.
Fair enough. But you know, I worked in the Senate during the last 2 years of the Bush administration. And we confirmed 68 of President Bush's nominees in the last 2 years with Democrats in control of the Senate. And I think that number was in the teens in the last 2 years? So it wasn't just Merrick Garland. We have had a complete failure of any kind of comedy on both sides. So I almost think the filibuster question, the nuclear option, is a piece of a larger problem.
Yes.
And the problem has to be to restore the legitimacy of our institutions and how they're supposed to operate.
We are taught from an early age that justice is blind. Indeed, Lady Justice, depicted on the mural of the City Club here, is depicted with a blindfold. So in that context, I heard two comments tonight that are very disturbing to me and frankly a little offensive. One was Jeremy Paris said, who is the court or the judge for? And the other one was by Sara Schiavoni, whose side is he on? Really, Justice Professor Adler, isn't the right question is, will the judge follow the law? Will he follow the Constitution and the law, irrespective of who the litigant is, and not take sides?
I mean, I know they'll want to jump in. Certainly my view, but let me say, and Judge Gorsuch has said several times, both when he was nominated, and he said this in his speech at Case last year, that if a judge always likes the outcome of their decisions, they're doing their job wrong. One thing I will just throw out as something that we have to acknowledge is that, you know, something I tell my students, right? Judges are people too. And we know a lot about how we're all subject to motivated reasoning. One of the reasons we have multi-judge panels on appellate courts is because we recognize that having more than one judge on a case and being able to discuss it is actually going to improve the decision making, and so I do think it's when you take account of that and you recognize that the Supreme Court is hearing the 70 legal cases in a given year of the thousands that people seek certiorari on that are the hardest. Right, the vast majority of those cases are cases in which lower courts, really intelligent, thoughtful judges acting in good faith and goodwill, have disagreed, because most of the cases the court takes are circuit splits. Which means they're hard. And so I understand why, you know, knowing that a judge does have a certain jurisprudential outlook that fills in some of the gaps, or a general political outlook that informs the way they understand things, why we think that will influence some cases. And it's most likely to influence some cases where the traditional legal materials runs out. But I agree with you that the rhetoric of the court or about the court in recent years, talking about who you're for, about litmus tests for decisions, which a lot of folks have engaged in, including the president, is very unhelpful and undermines the ability of the courts to do what we want them to do, which is to apply the law neutrally and fairly as much as they can.
But you know, Jeremy, isn't that the reason why we have cases to look at, a record to look at, to evaluate, to determine how likely it is that this individual may come out in a certain way if a particular issue came before?
That's right. Look, I understand and respect, you know, where you're coming from with that question, and you know, it's, and I really also respect, you know, Jonathan's answer, which I think is absolutely a great distillation of what the tough project of the Supreme Court is. You know, I'm actually going back to, you know, the first nominee I worked on was Chief Justice John Roberts, who famously, by the way, the all-time MVP of judicial nominees. He was in soft focus in real life when he was up there in the hearing room. But you know, he started the hearing by saying, judges call balls and strikes, and it speaks to this idea of judicial modesty, of the judicial role. First of all, the Supreme Court doesn't call balls and strikes, they decide what the strike zone is. Second of all, this nominee was nominated by a president who said, I want a nominee who's going to overturn Roe v. Wade on day one. That is the precedent that has been reinforced in Casey. It was reinforced, and if all he was doing was calling balls and strikes, there's no way Roe would be in peril or narrowed. And yet that could happen. And you have all these 5-4 decisions where it's not that the four and the minority were unconscious of justice. Here's my problem with that notion of judicial modesty and what I meant by what courts are for, who courts are for. I worked on the Voting Rights Act reauthorization. It was reauthorized unanimously by the Senate, nearly unanimously by House, signed into law by President Bush. It was after 20 hearings. And this was the 14th and 15th Amendments to the Constitution say that Congress shall pass laws to enforce these guarantees. Congress acted responsibly. It looked at this, and the Supreme Court, by a 5-4 rule, gutted the key Section 5, that act, which I think led to terrible consequences in this last election in terms of people being able to vote and have access to the ballot box in many states. Was that judicially modest? Was that balls and strikes? To me, that goes to the heart of who are the courts for. It's not that I think the court should be for somebody or somebody else in a particular controversy, but I think you have justices that believe this guarantee is this broad, some that believe it's this broad. And I think the composition of the court is going to determine that. So I actually think we really need to care about who the court is for.
But as Jeremy, you just noted before, the issue isn't for you one of modesty, not modesty, right? Because, I mean, Obergefell, we can like the decision, we can like the outcome. Clearly not a modest decision. Windsor, striking down the Defense of Marriage Act, clearly not a modest decision. The Boumediene case involving habeas rights for Guantanamo, 5-4 decision in the Roberts Court where Kennedy joined the liberals. The single most aggressive exercise of judicial review over a national security determination in our nation's history. Now, maybe it was right, maybe it was wrong, but no one's going to look at that case and look at a 5-4 court overruling it. And
I agree with you. I think judicial modesty is a thing that sounds good when nominees say what do they mean by it?
Well, I think what we mean by it, and I actually think if you look at the bulk of Chief Justice Roberts' tenure, you actually do see a fair amount of judicial modesty. It's one of the reasons conservatives have been critical of him, right? He generally tries to avoid overturning precedent. That's why it took two cases to take down the Voting Rights Act instead of one. He doesn't like decisions. He cobbled an 8-justice majority in the first Voting Rights Act case that basically said to the Senate, fix this, otherwise we're gonna have to reach the constitutional question. He goes out of his way to avoid overturning precedents. The Roberts Court overturns federal statutes and overturns precedents at far lower rates than the Rehnquist, Berger, or Warren courts did. Now again, we may think that's good or bad, right? If we don't like the laws that are being overturned,
then it's
bad.
Neutral, right.
Right. Right. But this is a descriptive matter. At the rate at which acts of Congress are struck down, at the rate at which that prior judgments of the Supreme Court are overturned, the Roberts Court does far less of that than its three predecessors. And so if we're going to say, is it more modest? Yes. Is it as modest in the right cases? Well, that depends who you ask.
That's the trick, right?
But overall, it is one that has tried to shrink on the margin, shrink the impact of its rulings, and people that like where Justice Kennedy goes on a given case are either happy or unhappy with that, depending on.
Should we bring in Sara to the
And I appreciate that critique. I think that critique, though, I think that we've seen a change in how the hearings and how people understand the court since we've had coverage of hearings in 1986. So 1986, cable news picked up literally gavel to gavel. People could watch it, they could turn it on. And that's when senators started to ask more substantive questions. So that's when we started to hear about winners and losers. So I think it's reflective of how the hearings are just portrayed, and it makes for good TV. So this is awesome for this audience, but people aren't as engaged. It's not salient to the public if we're not talking about winners and losers. And unfortunately, I think that's some of that is reflective of.
My question actually leads right from that. It's to Sara or Jeremy. So we heard a little bit about what the Democratic opposition might be. Judge Gorsuch is for the big guy. And Judge Gorsuch is potentially not judicially independent. You mentioned, Jeremy, I think you mentioned Hobby Lobby as one example. I'm curious if you would have more examples from, as Brandon mentioned, his 10-year record on the 10th Circuit, more examples of cases where he might not have followed the law to come out for the big guy, or might not have followed the law and been judicially independent, whether you guys have examples of that to put sort of from the generalities to the specifics and to see what we might be hearing in the next couple of weeks.
First of all, since you're about to go clerk for Justice Alito, I just want to say that I don't have the candle power you do, so it's an unfair question. And kudos to Jones Day for scoring another one. Right. You know, I think you know, and I don't have the names at hand, but there are cases, you know, limiting class actions, finding, you know, forcing mandatory arbitration, limiting employment discrimination. You know, these are all these kind of like bread and butter issues that are really unsexy, and yet they really matter for people's access to justice. And that is one of my concerns. And I, you know, I'm not immune to hearing. I mean, you're right. By the way, some of this is unfair because of circuit court judges are constrained by precedent, whereas Supreme Court justices have more free reign, though not total free reign, to change the law. This is why this whole process matters. The process of the Supreme Court is so hidden. It's not on TV, for good or ill. You know, you don't need necessarily a law degree, but you need to really be well-read to understand what's in a Supreme Court decision. Maybe we've over-professionalized what the court does. But this is the moment to unpack it and look at it. So you're sort of playing this game of guesswork on both sides. The last thing I want to say in response to that is, you know, I do think the litmus test thing is a challenging one. The Roe v. Wade litmus test, I know in this case, the list came from probably, you know, the Federal Society and Heritage Foundation, which are conservative. What were they looking at as their selection, you know, and how does that translate into what he will do for 25, 30 years? So, you know, I don't know, and I don't want to paint an image of him as a bad guy, but I do question whether he would be deferential, too deferential on environmental cases and others. But, you know, that's one of the things, like, there are always surprises, and we don't know.
And the other thing, and I'll go back to taunt Jonathan for just one second, but...
I'd also like to be taunted.
Okay, good. All right. So there is this tension between law professors who read these lower court opinions and always say that they are predictive of where we're going to see a Supreme Court justice. And we've just found them there's a fallacy of the expert, and they're not able to place them through even their votes, and especially from circuit court judges, because they're working in panels of three, and obviously we have a lot of unanimous decisions, and political scientists have actually found that judges who may be on shortlists, who think that they may be someday nominated, actually moderate and mediate their views and their votes. They don't dissent when they otherwise might. So I'm not convinced that even if we could name 10 or 15 of those decisions where they're terrible, that that's actually going to be reflective of where he'll be when he's on the bench. So I think it's interesting, and I think that it's that's something that we'll see in the hearings. We'll have all those decisions trotted out, and there'll be questions. But I'm just not convinced it's a really good measure of where he'll be vis-a-vis the other justices.
Yeah, I'm so sorry that we're at the end of the hour. Tonight at the City Club, we've been enjoying a panel conversation about Judge Neil M. Gorsuch, his nomination to the Supreme Court, and the future of the Supreme Court. I should tell you that CLEs are, in fact, available, and there's a sign-in sheet on your way out. Today's forum is sponsored by Jones Day. Thank you so much for that. Community partners for our forum are the American Constitution Society, the Cleveland Metropolitan Bar Association, Cleveland State University, Cleveland Marshall College of Law, the Federal Bar Association, Northern District, Ohio Chapter, the Federalist Society, and the Legal Aid Society of Cleveland. If there is another legal entity in the city of Cleveland, please let me know. We appreciate your partnership in promoting today's forum, and that brings us to the end of our program tonight. Thank you very much, Brandon, for moderating. I want to thank Professor Adler, Professor Schiavoni, and Mr. Paris as well. Not Professor Paris. One day, perhaps, yeah. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here tonight, and enjoy the nomination, the confirmation hearings. Thank you.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.